Okay, so it's now my pleasure to do the second part of the lecture today. So my name is Wolfram Höpken. I'm at the University of Applied Science, Ravensburg-Weingarten, and I'm working in the area of business intelligence, data mining and tourism now for 20 years. I started my business career at Start Amadeus, the Germans will know Start. It's the most famous reservation system in Germany, computer reservation system in Germany. There I started as a software developer. Later on then I worked together with Matthias at this e-tourism competence center in Innsbruck, where we developed those innovative mobile guides and applications like that. And then I moved on to Ravensburg Weingarten, and now there I'm responsible for the area of business intelligence, data mining, big data, all those things. Matthias already presented lots of different projects we did in the past. So I will now focus on the more or less the practical part, so the hands-on session. So the idea is that, especially in the afternoon, we will then use the tool called RapidMiner to really do those kind of analysis which we saw before in the morning, so to do some data mining, hands-on data mining. Now the learning goals are to give an overview of BI and data mining, but most of this has already been done by Matthias, and then to gain insight into the data mining techniques, and especially to gain practical experience in the application of those data mining techniques, based on this tool set RapidMiner, and to achieve the ability to gain knowledge from real world data. So we have a bigger data set, which in the second part we'll then look at this bigger data set and try to get some knowledge out of this data. Now the content of this second part will be a brief overview. Most of those things are, or some of them are a repetition what Matthias already said, so we can be quite short here. Then we will look at those different techniques, supervised learning, unsupervised learning, already explained by Matthias, the difference. And then the final part is then an application scenario. We'll look at some data, real world data, and try to do some analysis on this data. So this will be the structure, some references here. So these are two books. The Laos, for example, is a quite nice introduction to data mining, so not too complex. Liu is a bit more complex, a bit broader scope, especially on web data mining. And so we did lots of work there. Okay, the structure for this second part is a very brief motivation to the area of business intelligence and data mining, and this CRISP process, but most of this has been done by Matthias already. And then the second part is then the data mining software RapidMiner, and we will try to do this first part before lunch break. Then you can use the lunch break to install the RapidMiner software if you haven't done so far. And then after lunch break, we can then start with hands-on doing some exercises in RapidMiner. So we'll start with a couple of examples, and in the third part then use this knowledge and try to execute those processes on real world data. It's an eBay data set which we have collected some time ago, and then we can try those different kinds of analysis and to gain knowledge out of this data. Okay, this is the structure of this second part. Just as a motivation, there are some good examples of what is data mining all about, what is the idea of data mining. Here you can see that Facebook, for example, they found out that they can predict whether two people are or will in the future enter into a relationship. They can predict this 2 weeks ahead just based on the communication behavior of the people within Facebook. So if they send some private messages, depending on the content of the messages, they can quite nicely predict whether those two people will enter into a relationship or not. And if two people enter the relationship and they even might get married later on, then credit card companies, they can predict divorces by accuracy of 95%. This is quite interesting, because you could now argue what the hell is the benefit of knowing if two people will be divorced later on. But for example, if you are in the classical relationship between a man and a woman, if you are a man and you are divorced, you are bankrupt afterwards. You've got no money. So for a bank, for example, it would be extremely interesting to know 2 years before that somebody will have no money later on, so you won't get a loan, so they won't get a credit. So this would be extremely interesting information to know this. This of course only works when you are using the credit card quite heavily. So for example, you're buying flowers at a certain shop you never did before. Yeah? You're taking a different route back from home. Yeah? And then of course you can deduce that the behavior significantly changed, and therefore there might be something wrong in the relationship. So this is the idea of what you can try to get those patterns and deduce some interesting knowledge from those patterns. There are lots of examples, not only from tourism, but in general. For example, a bank, bank would like to know which customer characteristics influence the credibility of customers, obviously. This is one of the most famous examples of data mining. Or credit card companies would like to know which is suspicious behavior. If the credit card is used in a way which you can deduce that it's not, that it might have been stolen or lost. Or the FBI would like to know by which behavior you can identify terrorists, for example. This is one of the most famous examples of data mining. Or a retailer would like to know if certain products are often bought together. What Matthias already explained, this market basket analysis. Or in tourism, airline companies, for example, they're doing lots of research in this area. They, of course, would like to know which circumstances cause cancellations or no-shows. So how many people will not show up at the flight? Then, of course, you can sell the seat a second time if you know that somebody will not show up most likely. So airlines are investing lots of time in doing those data mining activities there. Or tour operators might be interested in specific requirements of different customer segments. Or hotels, again, would like to know which characteristics influence customer satisfaction, so to sell the hotel rooms to the right customer segments and so on. So there are lots of examples of where data mining can be used within tourism, but also, of course, in other domains. Now, this we can more or less skip because Matthias already explained what is data mining all about. Only one remark, perhaps important, is that it's large data, because if the data is quite small, you could calculate the exact solution. Then it's just a mathematical problem. But data mining is not about mathematical algorithms, but it's about heuristics. So you need some interesting idea how you can deduce this knowledge from large data, because the data is too large to calculate the precise solution. Therefore, most of those approaches get a bit more complex as they are heuristics in order to deal with large data. The rest, I guess, has already been explained. The current situation, of course, is interesting because based on the World Wide Web, more and more data is available nowadays, but the data is not used properly so far. So there are lots of data out there which are not used, and therefore there is lots of interesting projects or analysis which can be done there. So what I say, we are drowning in information but starved for knowledge. So lots of the information is not used properly to gain new and interesting knowledge. This again follows this CRISP process already explained by Matthias. And this is again this example of what we did in Sweden, this cancellation behavior. So here you see the different phases again. Business understanding just means that you do some kind of requirement definition. So we define, for example, we want to find out which factors influence the cancellation likelihood of customers, and whether we can predict whether somebody will cancel his booking or not. That was the requirement definition. And data understanding, so we collected booking data from SkiStar, which is the famous company there for skiing areas. And there we collected 1.2 million single bookings. Of course, in the next phase, the things have to be prepared. Typically, you have to prepare the data before you can do data mining. So we enrich the data, for example, by specific customer characteristics or past booking behavior. In the modeling phase, then this is the core phase of this CRISP process, then we did a classification by a decision tree in order to find out what characteristics influence the cancellation behavior. Matthias already explained most of the results. So one interesting part is that we could found a subgroup of customers who have an 8 times higher cancellation rate than the average customer. And this is based on the product which they booked, the time of booking and the past booking behavior. So this is of course a quite interesting subgroup which has got a quite high cancellation likelihood. Evaluation phase, this is typically, of course, you have to validate whether your model is correct or not. Yeah? And there we could reach an accuracy of 92%. Yeah? And the deployment phase is then, of course, what you want to do with the knowledge. So one, of course, possibility is just to do a report to get a better understanding of the cancellation behavior. All this subgroup of customers, these heavy cancelers, they, of course, could be tackled by specific marketing activities. If you, for example, send those customers perhaps some marketing messages, you could perhaps prevent them from canceling their booking. So this is an example of the different steps of this CRISP process, which can be used to execute data mining projects. Okay, so this was just a very brief introduction again into this topic of business intelligence data mining. So now we can go on with this data mining software RapidMiner in order to then prepare for this hands-on session. There are lots of tools out there which you can use for data mining. All those, all the big companies, of course, which are in this area of data analysis, databases, of course, they offer some data mining tools. For example, the Microsoft SQL Server can be used, or SPSS Clementine. SPSS is now part of IBM. It's IBM Cognos. They, of course, have a data mining tool as well. Or SRS, Enterprise Intelligence Platform, and they offer some data mining capabilities. Or Oracle Business Intelligence, or SAP is offering business intelligence and data mining software as well. So all those companies have such data mining software in place. But of course, the software packages can get quite expensive. But there are open source software available as well. The most well known is the Weka. It's from the University of Waikato, Environment of Knowledge Analysis. And they are offering this collection of data mining algorithms for free on the internet, which can be used there. And there's a small tool which you can use as well to execute those processes. Then there are other data mining tools out there, KNIM, for example, or NIME. It's from Konstanz Information Miner. It's quite well known in the open source domain. And finally, RapidMiner. RapidMiner has started as open source, but now it has been transformed into a commercial product. But there is still a version which you can use for free. There are some limitations, but it can be used for free, at least for educational purpose. And therefore, it's still a good choice. And RapidMiner and NIME are the most well-known open source or well-known software packages in this area. So we will use RapidMiner today. And NIME, for example, works quite similar. All those tools work in the same way that typically we will see later on. You don't have to program. You don't have to write source code in the strict sense. But you have to define a process, because data mining, you have to repeat the work all the time. It's not a good idea to do it by clicking somewhere, because then you have to do this all again and again. But you have to define a process which can be executed and changed and executed again. It's a high-level programming. So you put together building blocks which are doing some work. All those tools like SPSS Clementine work in the same way. So you can easily get used to other tools if you know one of them. So we will have a look at RapidMiner today to see how this works in general. Here you see an overview from Gartner, where they analyze different software in this area of data mining. There you can see that RapidMiner is quite well positioned. In this analysis is even better positioned than lots of the commercial software. So it's a good choice to be used. Okay, so now we can start with using RapidMiner. I don't know who already installed RapidMiner. Okay, some did, some not. So if you haven't installed it, we should do this now. So I put a README file on the Dropbox, so you can look into the Dropbox and there you can get instructions. Or you have to type in this link. You have to follow this link. Then you get to the installation page from RapidMiner. And there you can download the software. So this is the first what you should do. And if you click on this link, then you can install the software. And as soon as it's installed, you can start the RapidMiner Studio. And when you start it for the first time, you are asked to create an account, a user account. And in this user account, you have to specify some information. And afterwards, you can then use the RapidMiner as a free version. As I wrote in the README file, As a student, here you have the chance to use the educational license. So if you create your user account, you can check educational account, and then you after a couple of hours, I don't know how long it will take in specific, it depends on the traffic, you get a license key, and then you can enter this license key when starting RapidMiner again, and then you get a version which is has a bit more capabilities. The only difference is that this free version is limited to 10,000 rows. So your tables you're using, they are limited to 10,000 rows, and you only use one CPU, independent of how many CPUs you have in your server. But it's only in the server environment a difference. And in the free educational version, you get rid of this limitation of 10,000 lines. So then you can use as big files as you like. That's the only difference. So for the purpose of today, it's fine to use the free version because 10,000 lines is fine. But if you want to use it for other purposes, it's a good idea to get this educational license, and then you get rid of this 10,000 line restriction. So I think that's the best what we can do now that you all install RapidMiner, because otherwise we cannot, of course, continue.
Some people here that cannot install because they have not the possibility, because they have a laptop from their working place.
So you've got no root rights, then no administrator rights.
Here from the university, we try to look if we can give you one.
I mean, it's not necessary that that everybody works on one laptop. You can at least have share with two people. More than two gets a bit difficult, but two to share with two is a good idea, because even if you do some build your process on your own, it's a good idea to do it. So you can. So everybody who has got no laptop now, perhaps search for somebody who has a laptop, and then you can do a team, build a team, and then you can use the software quite easily. So who is without any access to RapidMiner at the moment? Who still has no access to RapidMiner? You're just downloading?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Okay, so we can let's perhaps continue, and if you miss something, then we can do this afterwards personally. So the first step, what you should do is there's a file called rapidminer.zip on the Dropbox, and you should unpack this in your local environment. So please copy this file to your laptop and unpack it somewhere. Because what we need is for the work we are doing is that we then need this as a repository file. So you can download this and unpack the zip file on your local environment. And then if you start the RapidMiner, if you start the RapidMiner Studio, you should see something like this, but without the pose in the middle. So you just see the empty RapidMiner file. So I can. If you start RapidMiner, there's an intro message which you can just skip. So there's some automatic process builder which we don't need. So this first intro you can just skip. And at the end, then you should see something. You should select blank. You see this is a typical start page, and you select a blank process, and then you should see something like this. Okay? So this is our starting screen. So start RapidMiner, you get some intro message which you can just skip. And then you select blank process, build a blank process from scratch, and then you should see this. Not necessarily all the details, because this different parts of the RapidMiner you can change, you can add if you like. What you should have, the repository area, you should have operators area, and you should have the parameters area at least. Yeah, these are the things which you need. Yeah. So everybody has opened the RapidMiner and can see this. Yeah. Okay. So what we can now do is that we just look at the first process. You can just go on the, if you go to the rapid, to the repository area, there should be repository samples. These are pre-built samples from RapidMiner. And there you go not under data, but you go under processes, and then 01 learner, and then the first one, decision tree. And just by double click, you... No, it's not depending on the license. Well, what is empty? Not on the data, on the processes.
Yeah.
On the open samples.
Okay.
And then on the processes.
Yes.
And then okay. No problem. Okay, then you open decision tree by double click, and then you should see this process. Yeah. So this is now a data mining process. It's like a program which can be executed, and then it does the work you want to do it. Yeah, so it's called a process, data mining process. We can just have a look at the general ideas. So each of those building blocks is doing some work. And of course, there are some data which are either produced or changed, and then the data is passed on to the next building block. So you normally work from left to the right, yeah, and you pass on the data to the next step, do something with the data, or learn a model, yeah, and then the output is then passed on to the right, yeah, to the next operator. Or if you are finished, it's passed on, yeah, to one of those output nodes. It is important if you want to see if the process is finished, you want to see any results. The results you want to see, they have to be connected with one of the output nodes. Otherwise, they are thrown away afterwards. Yeah. Now let's have a look what the process does. Those two things. The retrieve operator, it's quite simple. It just reads in data. Yeah. So the retrieve operator just reads in data from a data entry. If you go to the parameter area, you see where the data is coming from. So in this case, it's reading the data set Matthias already explained in the morning. Yeah. You see here, it's on the data, the golf data set. Yeah. So the golf data set is loaded. Yeah. So what we can do, of course, is you can look at the data. If you go to the data part, yeah, to the data folder, not to the process, to data, and you can see the golf data. This is what is read in here. And if you want to look at the golf data separately, you can just double click on golf, and you open the data set. So you can see how the example set is looking like. This is what Matthias explained in the morning already. These are the data we want to learn something from. Yeah? So you see, in RapidMiner and in all those data mining tools, you only work with flat files, with flat tables. So you've got a table, each line is one example, yeah? Each row is a characteristic and attribute of the example set. Here we see these are 14 days where the question is it recommendable to go golf playing or not? And you see the weather outlook, the temperature, humidity, and wind, and then you can see golf is recommended, yes or no. That's what Matthias explained, it's supervised learning. Supervised means that the target variable is only already existing. Otherwise, you cannot learn anything from. So you only need to know if you can play golf or not. Yeah. So and now what we want to do is we want to learn a model which finds out based on which characteristics of the weather we can deduce whether it's recommended to play golf or not. And if we have learned this model, we could then use the model to apply to new data where this information is not available. Then we could say for a new day whether it's possible to play golf or not. That's the basic idea. Yeah. So if we go back to the process, so we go back to the... There are two different views which we use, the design view then you see the process, and the result view is where you look on data or any other kind of results. Yeah. So if we go back to the design view, we see our process again. So perhaps we can even close this golf data set, because otherwise it might irritate you later on. So now in the design view, we see the process. And if we now want to execute the process, we can just click on this play button. If you execute the play button, then the process is executed. So you can see now he executed those two operators. Yeah? The first one retrieved the data, and the second one just builds a decision tree. The decision tree has already been explained by Matthias. Yeah? So it builds a tree which tries to find out whether golf playing is recommended or not. Yeah? And without going into details so far, if you go to the result view, we now see the decision tree. Yeah. The decision tree is the model which has been learned. So this output node here provides the model, in this case the decision tree. And we passed it on to the output node, and therefore we can see the decision tree later on. This is the basic idea, how those processes work. Yeah. We retrieve data, we pass on the data as input to the decision tree operator. This abbreviation means training data, so he expects data where the target attribute is already there, otherwise he cannot learn anything. And he produces a model. The model in this case is the decision tree. Then the decision tree is passed on to the output node, and therefore we can at the end look at the decision tree. And if we do this, here we can see what the model learned. Yeah? So now we can classify data in golf playing yes or no. In this case we see it's a perfect solution, so the leaf nodes are all pure. They have only got one class. There's no mixture of different classes. So you can say if the outlook is overcast, you can go golf playing. If it's sunny, normally you would say if it's sunny, you can go golf playing, but most of the golf players might be a bit older. Yeah? And therefore, if it's sunny, but it's the humidity is too high, they won't go golf playing because they might collapse. Yeah? And therefore, they only go golf playing if it's not too humid. Yeah. And if it's rainy, you can go golf playing if there's no wind. You can use an umbrella. But if it's windy, umbrella won't work, and then you won't go golf playing. So that's the basic idea. So that's the idea of a decision tree. It just splits the data again and again until it reaches a good split where each leaf is as pure as possible, has only one class in a perfect condition, or at least one class is something like 90% and the remaining class is something like 10%. So this is the basic idea of how the decision tree works in general. Yeah? It just splits and splits the data until it gets a good idea of how you can split the data into golf playing yes or no. But we just wanted to look at the general idea of those processes. If you build more complex processes, you could even execute the process step by step, and after each step you can look what's the current output. That's a good idea, because if you build a more complex process, you want to check whether the first operator did what it should do before you continue with the other operators. You can set breakpoints. For example, if you click on this retrieve operator, you can say with the right mouse click a breakpoint after. This means the process is executed only till here, and then you can see what's the output. What we should see here is then, of course, the example set, the golf data set. So if we now execute the process, it stops after the retrieve operator and shows you Das sind wir noch gar nicht. Sollten wir den Sample, ihr solltet das Samples öffnen.
Ja, aber dann habe ich keine Daten dran.
Wie, keine Daten?
Dann ist es leer.
Ja, das macht ja nichts. Und die Daten sind ja, unter Data sind die Daten, die ihr hier braucht.
Genau.
Lass den ganzen Prozess mal laufen. Der läuft doch durch. Läuft der?
Ach, da passiert noch was.
Ja, du musst auf Play klicken oben. Klick mal auf Play. Dann geht's doch.
Ah, jetzt sind wir. Danke.
Okay, again, for those who never used tools like this, yeah, you have to separate between the process. Yeah, so this is only the instruction, what should be done. But nothing has been done so far. Only if you click on play, it's executed, not before. So if you open a process, it's just the instruction, what should be done. You have to click on play to execute the process. Yeah, and then you should get a corresponding result. Yeah. Don't know why this is not working. Okay. Okay. So that's the.
Gives you a table.
Pardon?
It gives you as a result.
Yeah, normally it should for some.
With the breakpoint.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Exactly. Okay, so that's the basic idea of executing processes and looking at the results. So if you execute a process, you end in the typically in the result view. There you see all the results. In this case, it's the decision tree. Yeah. And if you go back to the design view, then you can execute the process again, and so on. Yeah. So this is how. So with the breakpoint, you click on breakpoint after. You execute it, then you see the table. Why the table? Why not the decision tree? Because now you are there. Yeah. This has been executed, and the output which is available now is this which is passed from there to there. This is the example set which has been retrieved. Yeah. So this is just the example set which is then passed on to the decision tree. Yeah. And if you would enter a breakpoint after the decision tree again, then of course you would see the decision tree in the next step. Yeah? So now the process is there. Yeah? And if you then finish, nothing changes because it's again the decision tree. Yeah? So this is the way how it works. So you can then execute your process step by step in order to see, to check, to cross-check what has been done. Because otherwise, if you just execute a bigger process, you might wonder at the end why it didn't work, and then it's hard to find out where is the mistake. If you go through it step by step, you check after each step whether it worked well, and then it's more likely that you find the error. Yeah. So that's the basic idea. The processes we will work here are quite simple, but of course, in those projects Matthias presented, of course, those processes tend then to get quite complex. So you can build huge projects, huge processes there. Yeah. There's lots of different operators, but today, of course, we'll work with quite simple. Yeah.
Could you just try to get another sample? Because I have the feeling that you're not.
It's not working on you? Or is it working?
So we have now.
Golf thing? You have to
favor thing? Okay.
Yeah, and then they get a golf. Yeah, so it works.
Okay, so but now to get into another graph, so into another sample. We had the feeling that we tried to use another sample, but again we got again the same decision.
Okay, if you go to the design view again.
Yeah.
Then of course you can go to the
here.
No, that's the data. You have to go to the processes folder again.
Okay, no.
And there you can select a different one. Like we will do this.
Yeah,
okay. So is everybody familiar with the general idea of the RapidMiner? Yeah. So all the processes typically start with loading data into the process, and then doing something. First you will start with some pre-processing typically. You change something on the data perhaps. At the end, you will execute a decision tree, for example, to learn a model on the data. That's the typical way how this works. Yeah. Okay, so perhaps we make a break now, make the lunch break. Yeah, then I can cross-check whether everybody is fine so far with the RapidMiner installation. Then we can go on with more examples after the lunch break.
Please raise your hand if you need another.